So, the next speaker is Johanna Giovannini, who is neither from Italy nor from Germany, but from a linear combination thereof in Normandy. And she will talk about the Norman version of pharmacophores. Let's see.
Okay, so hello everyone. I'm a postdoctoral student. I work under the supervision of Professor Ronan Bureau, so at the University of Caen, Normandy. And I'm here to talk about a particular pharmacophore exploration toward a particular ligand set. So first of all, let me give you a little bit of context. So we work in the protein kinase context. Those proteins are involved in many cellular events, such as transportations, growing, metabolism, signaling, secretion, and so on. So this explains why, in a pathological context, those proteins may cause cancers, inflammatory, metabolic, autoimmune, and even neurodegenerative diseases. So this justifies the major therapeutic interest for the development of kinase inhibitors. So this is the classical representation for the kinome tree, so all the protein kinase we know in the human body. It's about 500. They can be classified according to their substrate or to their structure, to their localization, or even according to their role inside the cell. Despite being very, very used, those proteins share the exact same mechanism of action. In fact, kinase are proteins that are able to either activate or deactivate another protein through a phosphate group transfer that they take on the ATP. So in the literature, we can find, I put six, but we can find many different types of protein kinase inhibitors. The first two types of protein kinase inhibitor we know are what we call competitive inhibitors, because they take place in they take the ATP place in the binding site to the kinase protein. And the third type is what we call an allosteric inhibitor type, because it doesn't prevent the ATP to bind to the kinase, and it binds to the kinase through an adjacent binding site. We know several more types, but they are less known in the literature. And here we work in the BCR and ABL protein context. This protein comes from the abnormal fusion of two genes, the BCR gene and the ABL gene. And the fusion protein coming from this fusion is intracellular, and it's involved in chronic myeloid leukemia. So let's talk about pharmacophore. In our lab, we develop an in-house software that is called NORMS. NORMS is able to automatically compute pharmacophores from a large dataset of molecules. NORMS can also be used for the screening of molecular databases, for the search of multi-active molecules, and even for the definition of a pharmacophore space. And let me to show you how NORMS processes. So first, we have to give to NORMS a molecular dataset. So often it is an SDF file. Then NORMS will be able to compute every combination of pharmacophoric feature. So it's topologic pharmacophore, knowing that it exists six essential pharmacophoric motifs. At this level, we can give to NORMS two constraints, the pharmacophore order. It means that we can keep only amounts bearing a certain amount of motifs. And we can also keep pharmacophores that have a certain frequency threshold, depending on the molecule, on the number of molecules we want to be covered by the pharmacophore. Then this is an example of representation we can find on NORMS. So NORMS will give you the topological pharmacophore. So for example, this pharmacophore bears five motifs. Then we can see the superimposition of the pharmacophore with a molecule that is covered by the pharmacophore. Here is the list of the molecules that are covered by the pharmacophore. So we can see that there are 11 molecules. In green are the active molecules toward the BCR-ABL, and in red are the inactive molecules. And NAND is also able to compute a metric that is called the growth rate. So the growth rate is the ratio between the fit frequency of a pharmacophore within the two groups, so active molecules versus inactive molecules. So in our work, we worked on a ligand set that we retrieved on the Campbell database. So we retrieved a ligand that had an information toward the ABL1 protein. We kept only the small molecules for which we had the information of the either the KI or the IC50. And with this constraint, we retrieved about 1,500 molecules, and nearly half of them were active toward the ABL protein. So we gave this ligand set to NAND, and we asked our software to generate all possible pharmacophores varying from 1 to 7 motifs. And then we retained only the pharmacophore that had a minimal support of 10 molecules. With this constraint, we generated a pharmacophore set of more than 112,000 pharmacophores to study. So this was a huge amount to study, so we decided to build a pharmacophore network through what we call a directed acyclic graph. So here is an example of a directed acyclic graph. So we can see the representation of the pharmacophore. So each circle is a pharmacophore motif. Here you have the legend, and the distances represent the topological distance between the two motifs. So we can read this graph from the top to the bottom, and at each level we read, we add one feature, so one pharmacophoric motif. Then we can say that two pharmacophores are linked together if one is included into the other. For example, if we look at those two pharmacophores, we can see that the RD one is included into this one, so these two pharmacophores share what we say a family link. So a parent and a child. Then at this level, we work with pharmacophore, but we always have to consider that behind every pharmacophore, there is a molecule subset. And sometimes it happens that a distinct pharmacophore cover the exact same subset of molecule. So for example, let's take one example. Let's consider one molecular subset represented by this purple diamond. And let's imagine that those 5 pharmacophores, they are different, but they cover the exact same subset of molecules. So those 5 pharmacophores form what we called in our lab a general equivalent class. Okay. In our study, we wanted to be more precise. We wanted to study equivalent class of pharmacophores, but sharing a family link. So we defined what we called a structural equivalent class. So let's consider those 2 other subsets of molecules, the green one and the yellow one. Well, we can see that the green ensemble of pharmacophore, they all cover the same subset of molecules, sorry, and they all share a family link. So the green ensemble is a sub-ensemble of the purple, and it forms what we call a structured equivalent class. Okay? So depending on what we want to study, we can consider either the smallest pharmacophoric description, what we call a generator, or we can choose to work with the greatest pharmacophoric description, it's what we call a closed pharmacophore. In our work for now, we only consider the generator, so this allowed us to go from a rational DAG to a structured equivalent class clusterized rational diagram. Sorry. Then there is another notion we have to consider. We have to consider the sibling concept. So I told you that pharmacophore have a relationship, can have a family relationship, so parents to children, but they can also have siblings. To know the sibling of one pharmacophore of interest, we have to consider its parent. So for example, if we consider this pharmacophore, it has one parent that it's called H. And then if we consider all the descendants from this pharmacophore, well, this list of pharmacophore will form a sibling. So let me show you how we apply the directed acyclic graph on our initial subset of 112,000 pharmacophore. So this is a graph showing you the number of the initial 112 pharmacophores divided in the number of motifs they are bearing. And if we consider only the generator of the structural equivalent class of pharmacophore, we go from 112,000 to 15,000 pharmacophore to study. So this is the first decrease of the number of pharmacophore to assess. And then we can see that the pharmacophore bearing from 5 to 7 motifs were quite redundant in the initial dataset because they were represented in a smaller pharmacophore from order 3 to 4. So, at this level, we had 15,000 pharmacophore to work with, so at a human level, it was still too much to study. So we wanted to look for remarkable pharmacophore. How did we do so? Well, we called remarkable pharmacophore PAD. PAD stands for pharmacophore activity delta. And we were searching for outstanding details among pharmacophore, so among small pharmacophore that we call generators. So for each pharmacophore in the 15,000 set, we computed the growth rate. And then we defined that a pharmacophore activity delta, so PAD, was a pharmacophore for which the growth rate value differed by at least 2 times the standard deviation of the mean year value over itself and its siblings. Let's consider this concept with a small scheme, it will be easier. So imagine that we are working with this ensemble of 3 siblings. So all these pharmacophores have their own growth rate value. So you can compute the mean growth rate value for each pharmacophore and the standard deviation. Then if you compute the difference of one growth rate value, the difference to the mean value, and that if the difference is greater or equal to 2 times the standard deviation, then the pharmacophore of interest will be what we call a PAD, a pharmacophore that has a deviant behavior. Well, from 15,000 pharmacophore to study, we landed on only 32 PAD. So 32 at a human level, it's more affordable. So what can we say about those 32 PAD? Well, nearly half of them were related to mainly active molecules, and half of them were related to inactive molecules. Then if we look at the number of motifs they were bearing, well, the majority of those 32 PAD were bearing 3 motifs, 3 pharmacophoric motifs. And if we consider the molecules that are covered behind those 32 PAD, well, starting from our initial dataset of 1,500 molecules, we landed on less than 300 molecules to study. So here I will show you an example of the study of order 2 PAD, so pharmacophore bearing only 2 motifs. So here is an example of a family of pharmacophore bearing 2 motifs. They are all PAD. When we look at the molecule behind, we can immediately see different behavior. So the 2 pharmacophores, the 2 first DP20 and DP19, they are both related to active molecules, but the molecules they cover do not have the same behavior when they bind to the kinase. At the opposite, the last pharmacophore, DD1, the small pharmacophoric description that is a sibling from the 2 first, but it covers only molecules that have no activity. So I will show you in more details. So the first, let's consider the DP90 pharmacophore. So the DP19 covers only green molecules, so only active molecules. What we can say about those molecules? Well, they share two same characteristics. They all have a constant phenol in terminal position that occupies a hydrophobic pocket. They all have a central linker, a phenyl benzotriazinamide, that is able to angle properly the 2 terminal moieties of the molecule. And the only difference between all those molecules are this moiety, that is always alkaline, but that can vary a bit, that is able to interact with an aspartic acid. Then this pharmacophore is representative of protein kinase inhibitor of type 1. Then if we consider a second pharmacophore, At first sight, we could see that those two pharmacophores would have the same behavior for the molecule. Well, this was not the case, sorry. So the DP20 also covered only active molecules. But when we looked at how the molecules were interacting with the kinase, well, we could see also a constant central benzene for the hydrophobic contact. We could also see something that was constant at the terminal moiety, which was a pyridolo pyridine. And also we could see an alkaline moiety that was able also to interact with an acid residue, but the difference was that those molecules were larger than the first pharmacophore and they were classical of what we can find for the protein kinase inhibitor of type 2. At the opposite, if we consider the last sibling, the DD1, it's a small pharmacophore, so two hydrogen bond donors spaced by only one covalent bond. It only covers inactive molecules, but it gives us a really quick information that N-hydroxyamide entities were all related to inactivity towards the kinase protein. So what can we say about the study of PAD siblings? Well, they offered us a very quick and global visualization of different molecular assemblies. Then we might want to go further into the structural entities and the pharmacophore-directed acyclic graph. So a collaboration with the University of Bordeaux developed an interactive visualization tool where we can load our data of pharmacophore. And we can choose to work only with pharmacophores that are relevant. So the pertinence is directly linked to the growth rate value. Then we can choose to click on one pharmacophore that we want to study. And then the visualization tool will automatically build the DAG related to the pharmacophore we choose to its parent with a diamond shape, and all its siblings with a circle ray. The circle shape. So there is also a color code that is related to the growth rate. And so if we want, we can choose to click on another pharmacophore of interest, so one sibling of the first pharmacophore we wanted to study. And on this visualization tool, we can click on the show pharmacophore, and the tool will show us all the generators and all the closed pharmacophores for the pharmacophore we just clicked on. And then, if we want, we might want to study the molecules that are behind those two pharmacophores, so the blue one and the green one. So we can just, by intuition, click on show molecule, and then there is a little bit of downloading time. And then each circle will be a molecule of our initial dataset. So each circle is one of the molecules from the 1,500 molecules. The blue circle stands for the molecules that are covered by this pharmacophore, the red for the second pharmacophore, and the green circle is related to a molecule that is covered by both pharmacophores. So to sum up, starting from our initial dataset of 1,400 molecules, we landed on less than 300 molecules to study. How did we do so? We did so by the generation of pharmacophore, by the reduction of the directed acyclic graph, and by the computation of pharmacophore activity delta. What else have we done on this initial dataset of pharmacophore? Well, we have also studied the representative subset of pharmacophore. So for this study, I invite you to come to poster number 12 and meet Damien, a PhD student. We also have used new pharmacophoric descriptors, and for this I invite you to come at poster 42 and meet Ajar. And if you have more questions, we can talk about it either right now or around my poster at number 13. Thank you.
One or two quick questions.
Thank you for the very nice presentation. I have one question. You are using 2D pharmacophore. Did you compare the performance with another pharmacophore tool with 3D pharmacophore?
No, not yet. It's only the beginnings.
Okay.
So did you consider combining, because pharmacophore labels are not unique. You can be acceptor and donor at the same time. You can be hydrophobic and aromatic at the same time. So do you consider nodes with multiple features, or do you just consider the many pharmacophores, each could match the same atoms, but with a different label?
Yes, at the time we work with different labels.
Okay, interesting. And well, you saw that very simple pharmacophores, but with very long topological distances, are rare enough, and by chance they only include actives. But we well agree that it's by chance, because they don't tell you anything about what has to be in between, and I doubt that you can change that indefinitely without breaking the activity. So this is an
But this is only outstanding details. It's outrageous to work only with the generator. Yeah. In the second time, we will work with the greatest pharmacophore description, so the closed pharmacophore.
Maybe it's safer, but well, it's a good way to look at the data and to understand biases. It's an excellent tool. Thank you.